just real quick show of hands, just so I know who I'm talking to. Used Kibana any random version?
Okay, so that's basically everybody.
Okay, well, that's easy. Used 3. Used 2. Whoa! Used 1. No! Wait! Really? It's awesome!
I love it.
Wow! Okay, 1 was written in PHP because the company I happened to be working at the time was like, all we deploy is PHP apps, so it was the only thing I could write it in. So that lasted for like a few weeks or something. That's pretty neat. You were like early adopter. Cool. All right. So how did we end up getting to 4? So when I was developing 3, 3 was kind of meant to be a dashboard for 2, frankly. At which point we figured out that 3 could basically do everything 2 could do anyway, but a whole lot more. So we just called it 3 and we're like, all right, here it is. And the idea was to take what we had in 2 and make it a lot more flexible. And so, right, 3 was kind of this collection of panels that were sort of parameterized, and you could fill in the field, there were a bunch of checkboxes, right? But every panel in 3 did kind of one thing, right? And they were very closely tied to Elasticsearch facets, which were not exceptionally flexible. They were really powerful and really useful, and for a while they were faster than aggregations, which isn't really true anymore, but you know, they were great at the time, and they were what we had. I don't know if anybody used facets real quick. Okay, so used aggregations. All right, so just real quick, facets versus aggregations. So in facets, each facet was kind of its own little like self-contained thing. They couldn't influence each other. So let me give you an example. We had this thing called the terms facet, and the terms facet could find, say, you know, the top 5 of something. And then we had this thing called the stats facet, and the stats facet could find like the min, the max, and the average of something. But you couldn't say find the top 5 things and then find the average of some field within them until the term stats facet, which I'm sure you can imagine was really just, you know, kind of a whole bunch of copy paste. But you can't do this indefinitely, right? If you wanted to find the top 5 of something and then the top 5 of something and then find the average of it, you couldn't do that with facets without performing a round trip, which was annoying and it was slow and it meant you had to implement it on the client side. And so Elasticsearch built aggregations. And so I was really, really excited about aggregations. And so I'm like, okay, how do I get this into Kibana 3? No. It just wasn't built for it. Like, it was rigid in the same way that facets were rigid. So what we had to come up with was something more flexible. So we're like, okay, let's build something that works with aggregations. And then let's also figure out how people are using Kibana in general. And what we started to realize is that people wanted a lot more flexibility out of Kibana. We were seeing an exceptional number of people that had started to hack on it. And we're like, okay, so we need to do 2 things. We need to make this more flexible for the people who just want to use it, and we need to make it more flexible for the people that want to hack on it. And we also need to figure out a way to make those things faster. Kibana 3 was great, but it could get slow, especially if you were working with really, really big dashboards. And so we're like, okay, we need to improve all of those things. We also need to improve the way that you use the application in general. And we identified that there were kind of multiple steps to solving a problem, and those could either flow into each other, or you could stop at one once you found the answer. And so we really worked to improve the discovery process of Kibana. And we kind of broke this down sort of into dimensions. So let me give you a real kind of broad overview of what I mean by that. So we'll call this kind of dimension 1. And dimension 1 is, I just need to find something in my index. Like, I've got a 500,000, you know, log records, right? I've got events streaming in, I've got a 500,000 of these things. I need to find that one failed SSH login. And that's not that hard, right? I type SSH, status failed. And there it is, there is my failed SSH login, or possibly there's a whole bunch of them, and hopefully there's not many more than 4, because otherwise it's getting pretty hard to process in one dimension, right? Even though I've got a few few things, I'm still really only dealing with one thing at a time, right? Like, I'm not exceptionally good at looking down a big list of things and figuring out, well, anything about it. Let me show you what I mean. So, I'm going to jump over to the Kibana Discover screen. And I happen to be looking at a list of users right now. I index all the users of this application. And so I'm in my users index, and I really can't tell much at all about this list. I mean, it's easy to, like, search for something, right? So, JPL News. This happens to be, all the usernames in this, their data is pretty made up, but all the usernames in this come through the bit.ly clickstream for USAGov. Is anybody familiar with that data source? This is like the one public logging data source that I've really found where like they've just published all of essentially their web logs. Basically, anytime you shorten a link to a US government website through Bitly, Bitly publishes it to this this WebSocket that you can just connect to and stream all of their logs. So I archived them for a long time. That's a lie. Somebody else archived them for a long time and I downloaded it. So that's the data we're dealing with, but it is at very least, you know, real data. So anyway, it's easy for me to find one thing in here. And even if I wasn't just dealing with users, if I was dealing with like what the users are doing, that's still pretty easy, right? I could like jump over into a list of everything that the JPL News user did.
Can you increase the font size?
I can try, let's see. To be honest with you, there's nothing on the screen that you want to see. I can make this font enormous and you still won't get anything useful out of this. That's kind of the point, right? Like, sure, we can look down this list and we can open up any of these and we can see, oh, you know, the JPL News user published a link to something on NASA. On June 13th at 7:13, I don't know what else they did or when they did it. I could scroll down this and try to figure it out. That'll just be irritating. Mostly because I'm dealing with these like big blobs of stuff. Of course, I can add columns here and make that less annoying. But let's face it, even if I do that, it's still pretty annoying. Even if I like sort this by time, it's still pretty annoying. Like, okay, I can tell that the last time the JPL News user was active was on June 30th. Before that, June 25th and 23rd. I don't really know when they were most active. I'd have to scroll through all 18,718 of the things they did to get any idea of this, and this is not something I can track in my head. And these are the kind of problems, obviously, we have with one-dimensional search, right? This is the reason that we make charts, which is, of course, something that we want in Kibana, because we don't really want this. We don't just want to look at stuff splayed out. You know, we want something nice where we can see the ebb and flow of stuff. So we want to be able to see things over time. Now, when I was looking at that last screen, I was really just looking at one user. I just kind of picked one out of a hat, which is, when you're solving an actual problem, not something you're bloody well likely to do, right? Chances are there's a problem, you know, there's a big spike there, and you want to know what it's all about. And so chances are you want to see, well, what are my top users, right? That's a really common thing. You know, what is my most active user? What's the most active page on my site? What page is using the most memory, that kind of thing. Those are common questions you ask. So you end up making a chart that's something like that, right? Where you graph the most common user off the left and all the ones going down. But there's kind of an issue with this. So first off, we can totally do the like time turning thing. If you remember Kibana 2, this is probably a pretty familiar screen to you. This looks a lot like Kibana 2, right? Time chart at the top, list of events below it. Totally common stuff. The big difference here is, of course, that unlike Kibana 2, Kibana 4 works with stuff that isn't just time-based. We kind of consider time to be special, right? Like, time is such an important dimension of anything that we should treat it as special,
So when you go to set up Kibana for, it asks you, hey, is this a time-based data set or not? And we just default to time because we're like, okay, most people are dealing with stuff that at least has a timestamp. And so if we know it's time-based, we'll stick a chart up there for you to deal with. Let's go ahead and get rid of the JPL news user there so we can see everything. Okay, so there we go. So of course, we can do stuff over time. And we do the top user thing, too. That's super easy. We click on users. And it gives you this very, very quick, frankly kind of naive count thing. The goal of that little panel is just to be fast. So really all it does is count up all the stuff, which is why it says 500 of 500 records, instead of, 451,000, which is the actual number of hits. So let's look at more than just what's in that table, because, right, that's what Elasticsearch is good for. If our data set was small enough that we could just load everything into the browser, we would just do that. But let's go ahead and visualize this. And this will just make us a really simple bar chart of, what our most popular users are. And right, this looks a lot like the thing we saw on the other screen. And there, I think number 5 there is JPL News. So we can see that it's not the most prolific user, but it's not the least either. This by default just counts the top 20. But it's kind of an issue going between that last screen and this screen. On the last screen, we answered when things happened. On this screen, we answered who did them. But what we haven't answered is who did what when. And that's because we're still just dealing with two dimensions. And there's not necessarily a good reason to do this, right? When we think about dimensions, we usually just think about it as, oh, well, there's one dimension, two dimension. And then we think three dimension as this thing that like jumps off the screen at you, which is just horrible. I can rail for ages about three-dimensional charts and how much I dislike them. Unless like you're wearing 3D glasses, at no point should a chart ever jump off the screen at you. Unless you can like physically walk around it and look to see what is in the back, it shouldn't be three-dimensional because chances are something's just going to get hidden. That said, there are other dimensions than Z. There's other observable things. So what do I mean by that? So I'm going to get rid of bar chart. Bar charts are not honestly my favorite chart. I tend to think line charts, even though many times they lie to you, are more useful. So I'm going to jump in here and I'm going to make a line chart. Or I'm just going to make a big empty white thing, which is not actually what I've got there. You may have spotted a tiny green dot up there. There it is. Hey, little green dot. Well, that's really all we know. We don't know much more about what you want to do. We can probably take guesses at it, but we'll let you be explicit. So all we've done is you asked us to make a chart of the USA Gov Index. And most of what we know about the USA Gov Index is that it has 451,000-ish things in it, at least in the last 2 years. So we're back to that one dimension thing. All we're doing is count. Let's go ahead and add another dimension. So let's add an x-axis aggregation, and we'll add a date histogram. Okay, so timestamp, and we'll just make the interval auto. You can select other stuff there, but we'll just let Kibana figure it out for us. Okay, so now we've got something that is, vaguely close to what we had back over here, right? Big spike there, go back over here, big spike there. Pretty close to what we had, but we're still at the two-dimensional thing, right? And what we wanted to do was we wanted to meld the users and the top users with what they did when. So what are the ways we could go about this? So we could just add another y-axis and like throw a bar chart on there, which would be totally useless because we might as well just create two separate charts. There's basically no correlation in that. So we need another dimension. And second y-axis is not going to be it. Let's use color as a dimension. Right now everything's just green, and that could be any color. It's essentially meaningless. It provides no separation except for not being white. So let's split the lines up, and let's run terms aggregation across our user field. Okay, so I asked for the top 5. That's quite a lot more than 5. So, there's a reason for this. There's a reason that that's more than five. Even though I asked for just the top five over there, the reason has to do with the way that Elasticsearch aggregations work. So, yes, I asked for the top five, but there's context. What I actually asked for is the top five within each bucket in the date histogram. What do I mean? So, for those of you that use Kibana 3, you might remember that little eye icon that was in the top right that would show you the request that Kibana made to get your data. You still have that. It's way down here at the bottom on this little chevron thing here. So if you click that, it'll open up a table, and we won't deal with the table for now, but we'll get back to it. We'll go over to the request. And we're going to scroll down, and hopefully I've got enough resolution here to actually show this. I do. Nope.
Got to zoom in.
All right, well, we're going to try zooming. Well, but that actually worked. Wow, that worked better than I thought it would. Okay, we're going to end up making it smaller again in a second, but I'm actually kind of surprised the way that's it. Excellent. Anyway, so what did we actually ask for? So we asked for a date histogram, and so this is going to make buckets in the interval of 1 week, and then it's going to create an aggregation within those buckets, and that's where it's going to ask for the top five users, which is why we end up with so many. It's because the top five users change over time, right? So we might have five in 1 week, and those are different from the other week. We need to kind of move that around. So we're going to increase the priority of that. That's what those little arrow buttons over there do. So I'm going to increase the priority of this and hit go. All right, so now I've just got my top five users. So this is top five across time, not five within the bucket. And I can actually see something sort of interesting here within that spike, specifically that the JPL news user has an oddly outsized spike from the other ones. Whereas normally, it's like the lowest of the five, here it jumps to be way above them. But I don't know why that's happening. All I know is that it happened. There's two possible solutions. There's two possible things that could happen here. Anybody sysadmin at like a news site or something that has like inconsistent traffic, that kind of thing? Okay, yes, Wikipedia, right? So you guys probably get spikes on stuff all the time, right?
Yeah. When people die.
People, right, that's a bit more morbid than I was looking for, but yeah! When people die.
Get out of
okay. I'm just kind of bummed out. Anyway, there's two different things that could happen here. So, remember, these are logs of users accessing sites through a URL shortener. So, and these users, these are the users that created those links in the first place. So there's two different things that could have happened. Well, the JPL news user could have decided to get all markety on us and could have started creating a huge number of links, right? They could have started publishing a lot of new content. And just the fact that it might be interesting to a broad base could drive more people through their links. The other thing that could happen is maybe they just published one story that was really, really popular. But how do we tell? So the way that we would go about that is what we need to know is, compared to the other sites and their normal behavior, did the number of unique URLs that they publish, did that go up corresponding to the total number of hits? So let's take a look. So we need to add another dimension to this. So up to three so far, but we need another one. So we've already got X, and we've got Y, and we've got color. There are a couple other identifiable dimensions, at least here. And the easy one is just that dot size. If we look, there's a bunch of dots on here at every data point. And actually, frankly, the lines are kind of distracting at this point, so I'm just going to get rid of them so we can focus on that. So I'm going to get rid of the connecting lines. Okay, so now I've just got a whole bunch of tiny dots. But I want to make those dots bigger or smaller depending on some attribute of the documents that they represent. So I'm going to go back to data, and I'm going to add a new metric. And what I want to do is I want to say, well, take the dot size, which is currently static, and vary it based on some attribute. So in this case, I want to vary this on unique count. So the unique count of the destination. So is JPL News publishing more links? Let's find out. Okay, those are kind of small. I'm gonna make them a little bigger so we can see the difference a little better. It kind of makes the data lie a little more, but I'm okay with that. So, what can we see here? Well, the Bitly user, they tend to publish a whole lot of links anyway. The NASA Twitter user, they stay about the same. And interestingly, so does the JPL News user. They don't really change much. Which means it's very likely that they just had something that was really popular, right? Okay, how do we find out what it is? What did they publish that was so interesting? Well, let's click on a dot. And we're going to find out here is in reality, what's going on is not what we think. So, what happened when I clicked on that dot? Kibana said, look, there's a couple of different things that dot represents. A, it represents the JPL News user, but also represents a week of time. Do you care specifically about that week or that user? I don't really care about that week, so I'm going to deselect that filter and not bother applying it. I'm going to apply that. Okay, so without the effect of all the other dots, what we can see is that actually the JPL News user might have published a few more things than usual. Let's see, they published 39, or at very least there were 39 different links accessed within that bucket. So those 6,500 hits represent 39 different URLs. But usually, if we look down at the normal ones, normally they publish somewhere between 10 to 30, and they only get a couple hundred hits. So chances are still pretty good that they publish something fairly popular. So two things don't matter much to me anymore here. Separating this on user doesn't matter much to me. I've decided to narrow in on the JPL News user. So I'm just going to get rid of the split lines thing there, which didn't change anything at all. But time doesn't really much matter to me anymore either. What I'm going to do is zoom in on just that time period. We'll go in a little further. We'll just focus on just the spike. Okay, so now time really doesn't matter to me. So what I'm going to do is I want to see the destinations that are going on. So show me, say, top 15 destinations. Okay,
well, you notice that our dots have all gotten all small,
which is, of course, because each one of those buckets represents a unique destination, and the dot represents total unique URLs, so each one of them is one, right? Well, that's good. We kind of reclaimed a dimension. We can use it for something else. So we can see, at least somewhat, that indeed they had some articles that were more popular than others. If we look at their number 15, it had 202, and if we look at their most popular one, it had 1600. So kind of an eightfold increase. They had some popular links. Where did the traffic come from? Let's figure that out. So instead of destination, let's do refer. And actually, there's a neat trick here. You can see that I've got things mapped kind of funky. Every one of my string fields also includes a dot hash. And this is a kind of mild optimization. For the most part, the way we do unique counting is pretty fast, and so you don't usually need this. But you can actually pre-compute all the hashes that it uses to do the unique count ahead of time, if you want, by mapping a murmur3 field in Elasticsearch, which is what I've done. So instead of refer, because I don't actually care much about who referred it, I'm going to do refer.hash for the dot size. And so we can see what ended up happening was they had a particularly popular link that got shared pretty widely. This was shared, this had 187 unique refers, so 187 sites linked to it, whereas the biggest one actually only had 31. So these two combined were really responsible for a lot of their spike. Wonder what, whoops, I clicked on it, I didn't mean to. Oh, I just went back. All right, there we go, gestures. Okay,
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to sort my kind of view, this table at the bottom within the spy. I'm going to sort that by unique count of the referrer. All right, and so what was their popular thing? Let's see. Okay, well, their popular thing was apparently the Curiosity rover's Ichio. Okay, has anybody seen this picture? Is there any reason this is really? Were you really excited on that day? Because there were like thousands of other people that were really excited about this picture.
Oh, yeah.
There you go. All right. Cool. Chances are, you know, you were part of this. Neat. Anyway, so when we look through this process, we can see that we spent most of our time just within this one screen. We didn't have to go and create a whole bunch of different panels and add and remove things, right? We got to the conclusion that the reason that their traffic went up so much was that they published one or two particular articles that got shared very widely, and that's why they had such a spike. It wasn't that they went through some kind of marketing blitz or something. And this is kind of our flow for solving problems. We'll often start off thinking that we know what we're looking for. We'll start off and discover, and we'll kind of search around, and we'll look at stuff, and we'll realize that we don't actually know what we're looking for at all. And so we'll end up creating these pictures to guide us through that process. And much of the time, we can stop at the first process when we find the failed login or whatever. And much of the time, we can stop and say, okay, well, I found why traffic exploded. But only some of the time do we actually need to use that in an ongoing fashion. So what we wanted to do was allow you to save these things and reuse them across multiple dashboards. But not everything needs to end up on a dashboard. So you should still be able to save these independently and go back and reference them. And this was kind of the flow that we figured people often go through. The other thing we figured out is that people often needed to cross-reference this kind of stuff. So if you remember Kibana 3, you were kind of locked into one index per dashboard. That's no longer the case in Kibana 4. Kibana 4 visualizations are tied to an index, but the dashboard can have as many visualizations or panels as you want, and they can mix and match indices. Which means you get kind of a neat, like, client-side join effect. Get rid of that filter. So, alright. So, if we look here, we're actually looking at two different indices here. Make that a bit broader time range. We're actually looking at two different indices. The charts are all linking to what the users did, but that table is linking to the actual users. And because these share fields, because both the actions index and the users index both have a username field, if we were to say select a user off of here, and I'll just pick on JPL News again, we get the nice effect of being able to look up the stuff about that user, right? And actually, I'll talk about it in a minute, but we can even reference like external data stores, although you end up having to kind of link off to them. In order to make this kind of thing practical, we had to figure out some of the performance issues. In Kibana 3, if you made a dashboard that had like 15 panels on it, things really started to stall and get a little weird. There were a couple of different reasons for this. One was that we left the configuration of talking to Elasticsearch kind of, you figure it out. So what ended up happening is, you know, you put a proxy in place and, you know, a lot of people just jump to Apache. And there's kind of a lot of like default Apache templates out there. Unfortunately, a lot of those default Apache templates have this weird line in them that says, limit the max number of connections per user to 3. Super. So you got this thing that's got 15 different panels on it, and so the browser goes to make all these requests. That's how Kibana 3 worked. It just went out and it made requests for everything on the page, and it just separated HTTP connection for everything. So Apache would be like, yo,
Three at a time, guys. Three at a time. And so the browser would have to wait for the first one to finish before it could start number four. Wait for the second one before it started number five. And so you ended up with this like stair stepper pattern, despite the fact that you've got like 10 nodes in your Elasticsearch cluster, and it can definitely handle more than three queries at a time. So we fixed that in Kibana 3, or Kibana 4, in two ways. We got rid of the fact that you have to set up a proxy. We just built one, we built a backend. Right now, it really just proxies things to Elasticsearch with a little bit of request filtering. You know, we try to keep things to non-destructive GET requests. Only allow you to write into the Kibana index, that kind of thing. But for the most part, it's really there for performance, not for security. That's coming. The other thing we did is that Elasticsearch has a super useful feature called msearch. msearch is a way of saying, hey, take all these requests and just send them as one thing. Which meant that instead of blocking and waiting for things to finish before we start the next thing, we just kick off everything all at the same time and let Elasticsearch sort it out, which it does very well. We found that really complex dashboards, especially things that had long-running queries or even just lots and lots of short ones, many of those dashboards were reduced in loading time by up to two-thirds. So we ended up with a great performance benefit, and it meant that we had to repaint things less often in the browser because everything just came back all at once and we rendered it all together. It also meant that you got a really consistent view of the data, right? Imagine if you were running all these queries, you know, sequentially. New things are going to come into the index all the time. And so by the time we're done running all those, some things might have data that other things didn't. That doesn't happen with Kibana 4. So that's kind of how we got to where we're at. Although we're actually a little further beyond that right now. We released Kibana 4.1 last week. It came with some even more fun performance improvements. In Kibana 4, we had implemented a bunch of caching stuff. We're like, okay, we should cache this stuff. We were probably a little aggressive about it. You may have noticed that 4 used a lot of memory. We went back and we evaluated, okay, how effective are these caches that we had built in? A lot of them were just not that effective. So we got rid of the stuff that was basically full-time cache misses. We also did a big audit of how we were cleaning up listeners. That reduced memory. So in many places in Kibana 4.1, there's like a 10x improvement in memory usage in the browser, which is shockingly noticeable, or not shockingly at all noticeable. Other fun features that we've added in, we made filters a little better. So you could do stuff like filter maps, right? So if I have this heat map, I'll just make this full screen here, right? I can drill into some particular area. Also, that means that I've actually got a nice way of searching on that now. But I actually want to see the documents associated with that geographic region, the records associated with it. This is another new feature that we built into Kibana 4.1. This is called pinned filters. Pinned filters essentially let you take filters with you. So, an example of unpinned. I'm on Visualize, I jump over to Discover, my filter's gone, I've just got everything, because this wasn't within this context. The filter's not going to follow me around. If I mouse over this, and I select this little pin icon, I can pin it, and that way, when I go back to Discover, I've still got my filter, and the documents within this list are just the stuff that match that filter. Really useful for when you build up really complex filter chains on a dashboard, right? You're filtering in this panel and that panel, and you get it down to what you know, just what you want. Maybe you want to go build a new visualization based on that, or go and search the documents based on that. You can pin all those. There's a like mass pin thing you can do. The other thing we did was build in field formatters. This was one that we really wanted to do in 4.0 and just didn't have time for. We got it done in 4.1. This lets you define custom formats for how you want to view fields. Of course, you still have to search for them, how they're stored, but we've got things like a bytes field. I want to see it represented as kilobytes, megabytes, gigabytes. I don't just want to see a big number with no commas in it. That's annoying. So we built those in. So when you go and say add the bytes field,
get some stuff here. It's actually, it's actually nicely formatted as bytes. We've also got URL formatters, which nicely format things as links. And actually, these are templated too. I won't go too much into it, but even if you've got something that's not a URL, you can take the value of it and insert it into a URL using a template. So say you've got an ID or something that links off, and you've got, you know, another intranet application or something that can take that ID as a URL parameter. You can build a link, include that, represent it as a link in Kibana, and link off to your other application. There's a bunch more stuff in 4.1. There's a blog post. I won't bore you with all the details of what's in 4.1, but there's a whole bunch of new stuff. A lot of it's under the covers, but a lot of it's very visible. So what's coming next? The big thing that we're working on now is authentication. Whether or not you're using Shield. We did want to make it easier for Kibana users to use Shield. Shield just implements HTTP basic auth, which is fine if you use it with SSL, but it's kind of irritating in ways such as logout. You may or may not be aware, but the browser I've seen has any built-in way to forget your credential cache, which can be very, very annoying when you try to log out of an HTTP basic auth application. So we're just going to go ahead and handle that for you. We'll set up a session, you can set timeouts, we'll go back to Shield, ask, hey, can this user use this application? We're also making this extensible. And this is something that we're trying to do in many aspects of Kibana. So if you remember that formatter slide, it said bundled and custom. When we built field formatters, we wanted to build them in such a way as to allow people to build their own when they wanted to. You know, maybe you've got some special rules about how things should be presented, right? If this field is over this amount, it should be in red or something. You can do that with field formatters. Maybe you've got your own authentication system. We're building the authentication system, and we're building extensibility into it. We're building it with a documented spec, so you can add your own authentication plugins. We're starting to formalize the visualization schema, so you can build your own visualizations. And we're starting to build things out as apps. You may or may not have noticed, but it's not like I've been toggling back and forth between Keynote during this. I slapped this together yesterday. This is just reveal.js running in a Kibana tab. This is just implemented as an app in Kibana. We're starting to formalize this, but I wanted to make sure that it could be done nicely. And it's really a very simple thing, even in 3.1. So I put together a Kibana reveal app. So you can download it, you can plug it into Kibana, and all you have to do is drop it into the plugins directory and throw your slides in there. The Reveal.js author has this whole like nice online builder thing for Reveal. If you haven't used Reveal.js, it's just a slideshow making thing. It'll let you export it to HTML. You drop it into that directory, I think it's offline.html or something, overwrite that, and you'll have a new tab that you can use for your talk. It's nice if you're going to be toggling back and forth between like live demo sets. And we also want to keep you up to date with this kind of stuff. So it was about a month or so ago, we started publishing snapshot builds. Every time we have a successful build, it updates, and you can grab it. I'm not going to lie, this is kind of self-serving for us. We get a lot of great bug reports through these, so we encourage you to try these out on your desktop, not in production ever. And let us know if something's wrong or we can improve the experience in some way before we cut the release. The people who come to these meetups are the people who run snapshot builds, and they're the people we want to hear from. So grab them and try them out. And yeah, that's about it. That's where we were and how we got here and where we're going. Dammy. Questions I can answer? What's up?
Great talk. I have a question about the aggregation and this nested aggregation and so forth. I mean, if you're, let's say, coming from the data science sort of arena, you probably would love to have even a notch more in terms of functionality. I was thinking about rolling statistics, rolling momentum or cumulative statistics and so forth, rather than go all the way between all the data or just one single sample in it. So do you have any plans about it?
So depending on exactly what you're getting at, we are starting to build in series. They're kind of series transformers that will allow you to combine series or modify a series. Like, say I've got a constantly increasing counter and I need to take the derivative of it, or the second derivative of it. You can do that. What do we end up calling that feature?
Pipeline
aggregations. Coming in Elasticsearch 2.0. We're pretty excited to make use of it.
Also in terms of window statistics, so sliding window statistics,
yes.
Stuff like that.
Yeah, all you got it, I forgot the fancy names, but it's just a start, so derivative will be first, and then second derivative, running averages. As soon as you train a running average model, you can do projection, right?
Cool.
As well,
yeah,
so all of that is in the world. Open bottles?
Yeah,
that one is coming as well.
Okay.
And basically the point there was like aggregation was a platform for combining these statistics. We built a platform to do secondary aggregation on aggregations, like pipelines. So first make a timeline, then do some with the series, do time shifting, whatever you want.
Is it already out or?
No, it's in development. It will be part of 2.0. Elasticsearch put 2.0 will have the first ones and the infrastructure to build more.
Well, Elasticsearch also publishes snapshot builds, so
have fun.
Yo.
First, want to say thank you for building Kibana.
It's a whole awesome team of people. It's.
But you started it, right?
Thank you.
And of course, thanks for everyone involved. But the number one feature that I use in Kibana 3 is the shirts that you mentioned before, the facets.
Uh-huh.
And additionally, the thing that I find most interesting is also seeing, you know, the besides the top end, is it kind of the rest. And I know there are secrets around this, because it's slightly harder to deal with aggregation.
Yeah.
But it's a sort of best feature for me anyway. For I think all of my networks in Kibana 3 have that in it.
Yeah, me too. Absolutely. I also miss it, right? Like, you're doing a stacked bar chart, and you don't know if you're actually seeing the whole story. What you want to see is the top five and how they compare to everything else. So the tough part about this is because of aggregation, the way it deals with multi-value fields. One way we can do it is to use the parameter sum of other buckets that comes back, but that isn't really all of the other documents. Because fields are multi-valued, they can fall into multiple buckets. Adrian's working on it.
Can you just tell people don't use multi-valued fields, then the answer is right?
Yeah. If you don't use multi-valued fields, then the answer would be correct. Yeah.
Well, it's not deduped across shout still, right? So it's this double layer of error margins.
It's closer to correct,
yes.
Right?
And Elasticsearch does give you these days error margins. They are highly overestimated. So the important part about it, if it's zero, it's zero, right? And everything above. So for some people, that distinction is very important. But it's still very, if we in that case, it's exact, in this case, it's not exact, which makes it harder for a UI to communicate these subtleties, right?
Mm-hmm. Something we will work on communicating, though. Mm.
So, I have a question regarding integration. So one is like the dashboards and the widgets, are those also embeddable?
In
other parts?
Yeah, so it does. Let me go jump back over here. There's a little icon up here that will give you the code to embed it. Just a little iframe thing. You can adjust the size of it and whatnot, and you can throw it on a wiki or something.
Cool. And the same part also regarding integration, as you mentioned, a bit like feature-wise where the roadmap is going, but what's like the idea of Kibana? Is it more in the direction of being a Tableau for Elasticsearch, or?
Not necessarily.
For internal analytics mainly?
Not necessarily. A large part of our audience is people doing operations work, people analyzing machine data, and that is really the audience that we love. It's the audience that we know. It's what has made Kibana so successful. We want to bring the power of more sophisticated visualization tools to that audience.
Okay.
Yeah, first of all, thanks for the nice talk. I myself am quite new to Kibana and Elasticsearch, started playing a little bit with it.
Cool.
And I come from the data warehouse, BI background. Perhaps you mentioned that it's possible to join indexes now in Kibana 4. Can you say a little bit more about that and if it's going in that direction?
It's more of a conceptual thing, right? It's more of a view level thing. So definitely joins and indexes are not currently possible in Elasticsearch. If you happen to share the same field name across multiple indices and you throw them on a dashboard together, you do end up with kind of that effect. But the structures just don't allow for more formalized joins.
Okay.
Yes.
And Kibana is really useful because we get the aggregation query within Spark and then we join data together in there.
Yeah, that's part of the point of that little Spark thing was just to teach people how aggregations work.
One future thing. So Kibana has the dashboards with the queries for the specific queries in the set. It would be really nice if we share to produce also Java or Python query builder syntax for the common clients to export the gadgets and to embed it in the applications for the footage.
That'd be interesting.
Yes, because we work in R&D departments and so we use Kibana to analyze anomalies or work with data and analyze the data and so integrate it into new applications. So we use Kibana as data explorer current tool because Sans doesn't make sense most of the times.
Yeah, he's right here. Boaz is right here.
Yeah.
This is not America.
Inside, and so we have to we need to then transform this query after playing with it into a Java query builder or Python query builder, and say
that's a neat idea.
One or two standard syntaxes for official clients, for example, would be really, really good.
Yeah, that's a neat idea.
So one of the things, if that's just the query transferring of Sans query to code, that's the missing part, or do you need more?
Basically, yeah. Transfer in Elasticsearch or question.
Because mostly we use Elastic SLs, so we have lots of anti-patterns of using Elasticsearch, but it's a couple of separate talk. We basically would be really glad to have a translator of Sans or Kibana queries or dashboards into meaningful application integrated code, because then
I have two things to say to you. If it's an interesting talk, that you're welcome.
Yes.
And then, one of the things that we're trying to find time for is to have, you know how Sans has copy as scroll? So just to be able to copy a request as Python or something else, right? Mm-hmm. And also multiple requests in one go as well. So it's in the mid to do. Okay, so last question?
Yeah, one more. Dude,
I just wanted to react quickly on the business intelligence point. We actually use Kibana and Elasticsearch for real-time business intelligence, and currently we will just work around the issue by just chucking everything into one index.
Yeah.
It's totally valid. Normalize data
between one. Yeah. Just embed a JSON-serialized model. The biggest issue we actually face is that those real-time dashboards are so incredibly heavy, even in Kibana 4.1 as well. Only one person can actually view them in production without bringing down the web apps.
So we're making this better. We just merged it the other day. It'll take better advantage of the Elasticsearch query cache. So that should help some.
Okay. But anyway, you can do it in one index, and otherwise, for the time being, just do some random leader election on each chat program.
How do you handle the data quality issue that we have to do?
Okay, so two tips for you guys over there. There's Mark Harwood. Mark, can you raise your hand? That person. He has a talk about entity-centric indexing where he does all these kind of transformations to your data. So after the meetup, hustle him. Okay, so thanks, Rashid, again.